What do you mean by risk management? Or what are the type of risk that the company needs to manage? Okay, so here, as we told in the first class, when the company is properly going forward by making correct dividend policy, financing policy, and investing policy, okay. So when the company is making these three core operating policy perfectly, and they are going making sure that it will increase the shareholders' wealth. It will increase the shareholders' wealth. What happened ultimately?
There are potential risks associated with these decisions, and there should be methods of managing these risks.
Yeah, perfect. So externally, when the company is operating, they will get affected by two kind of risk. First one it is
Systematic and Achoo.
so that is inclined to the company. This is external. Okay, external means something which is affected by the company externally. The first type of risk is forex. That is when the company is doing some foreign operation. So let's say they have some foreign investment, or if they have a foreign currency transaction, or if they have some kind of trading with a foreign company there, because of the change in the exchange rate movements, they will affected by it. Because of the change in the exchange rate movement, that sometimes it can affect it adversely for the company's transaction. Sometimes this risk can affect adversely for the company's transaction. So that is known as forex risk. Apart from that, in the same way, there is, suppose if the company have taken any loan, when there is a change in the interest, even that will affect the company. If there is a change in the interest, and if it is affecting the company adversely, and if there is a change in the interest, and if it is affecting the company adversely, even we will consider it as a, okay. So the forex, the exchange rate part, we have to discuss these two elements. The first one it is, whenever there is forex exchange rate risk, it will affect the company. If there is an exchange in the exchange rate, sometimes if the company have any foreign operations or something like that, it can affect the company. Then we need to know that how we will manage that risk. In the same way, if the company have taken any investment, or the company have made any deposits, then if there is a change in the market interest rate, then it can affect the company adversely. Let's say if we are borrowed some amount for a variable interest rate, and if the interest rate is going higher in the market, then it is risk for us. If you are a borrower, and if you are borrowed at the variable rate of interest, okay, and if the rate of interest is getting increased in the market, then it's an adverse situation for the borrower. In the same way, for the one who deposit it, okay, his risk is, if the interest is going down, that will be a risk for the depositor. So whether the company can be either a borrower or the investor. Okay, so both of them will get exposed to this interest rate risk. That is, from the case of borrower, what is the risk? If the interest rate is getting higher in future, that's a risk of a borrower. And if you are deposited some money anywhere, or if you are an investor, in that particular scenario, you will get affected by that lower interest rate. In future, if the interest rate is going down, that will be the risk of a investor. So in the risk management section, we will be discussing about the different ways in which we can reduce that risk which the company get exposed to because of the exchange rate risk as well as interest rate risk. Okay, so in the risk part, we are discussing about two areas. What are they? The foreign exchange rate risk and the interest rate risk. foreign exchange rate risk and the interest rate risk. So whenever we are discussing about foreign currency risk management, whenever we are discussing about foreign risk management, we will always consider ourselves in an adverse situation. We'll always consider ourselves in an adverse situation. So adverse situation means we'll assume that if you are a seller, then your adverse situation is you will get a lower receipt than what you expect. That's an adverse situation for a seller. Okay. In the same way, if you are a buyer, if you have bought something from a foreign currency, if you are a buyer, then your risk is the higher payment. The higher payment will be your risk. Is it clear, everyone? So as a company, we will always assume ourselves in an adverse situation. Why we are assuming ourselves in an adverse situation? Because we'll assume, okay, if that adverse situation happens in the future, we have to make sure that somehow we should adopt some policies to reduce that risk. That's why we are always assuming ourselves in an adverse situation. That's the reason we are going for hedging. No, suppose if you are feeling that, okay, in the future everything will be, every situation will be favorable to us, then there is no point in hedging. Okay, so actually in the hedging, whenever you are going for hedging, we assume ourselves to be in adverse situation in future. That's the reason we are going for hedging. Okay, so for the forex, from the foreign currency risk management part, the risk is with regards to the receipts and the payments, right? So what's the risk with regards to receipt? You will get a lower receipt than what you expected. When the receivables are getting converted to the home currency, you are going to get a lower amount than what you expect. That's the risk associated with the receipt. And for the payment, what's the risk there? You have to pay something more than what you have expected. So the higher payment, because of the adverse movement in the exchange rate, you have to make a higher payment. So that's the risk with foreign currency management for the receipts and the payments. Okay, so what's the reason for this change? Let's say, for example, you have sold something today. Okay, so we'll discuss one example with regards to the foreign currency risk. Let's say you are about to receive 300,000 receipts, dollar receipts, in 6 months. Okay, so on the contract date, means on the date you are entered into sale, on the contract date, the exchange rate was, for $1 it is rupees 65. Okay, so that is a contract date amount. On the date of entering into that contract, the exchange rate was, for $1 it is rupees 65. And after 6 months, it is, for $1 it is rupees 70. Let's say the amount is 60. Okay, so what's the risk here? On the date when you enter into that sale, for every $1 you will get 65 rupees, so it will be debit receivable 19.5 million and credit sales 19.5 million, right? So we'll enter the entry, we'll pass the entry that rupees, if you are converting it into rupees, it is rupees 19.5 on the contract date and credit sales 19.5 million. But subsequently, after 6 months, when we receive the cash, it is debit cash. At this rate, the amount will get converted at this exchange rate. So it is $1 rupees 60. So how much it is? 18 million. But how much you expected? The receivables 19.5 million. So the difference is going to P and L as an expense, how much? 1.5 million. The difference will go to P and L as an expense, that is 1.5 million. So this loss of 1.5 million, how did this loss came? Is it because of the fact that the company is not performing well?
No,
because of the fluctuation in the exchange rate. So it is something that is affected externally for our business, and it is not under our control as well, because exchange rate is not under our control. So, but we have to take some remedies in order to protect ourselves from this risk. Okay, so whenever you are having some issues, first of all we'll check. Suppose let's say if you have any got corona. Okay, so before finding some solution for corona, first of all you guys, the doctors will check that what are the reason that will lead to corona, like otherwise what is the reason for this huge impact on our body, then only they can find a solution for it, right? In the same way here the company needs to hedge this risk, or the company needs to reduce the effect of this particular foreign exchange rate movement. So first of all, if you have to take some remedies, we should understand what's the reason for that fluctuation. Then only we can plan our hedging methods in accordance to that, right? So first of all, we'll discuss what's the reason for that change. So the currency value depends upon the supply and the demand of currency in our economy. So the value of any currency will depends upon the supply and the demand of currency in that economy. Okay. So first one, it is speculation. So what do you mean by speculation? So here I have told, Monday buy a pile of gold, Wednesday sell the gold and make a pile of money. So here we are purchasing gold on Monday with an expectation that the value of the gold will increase in the future, and they will resell it on Wednesday. So here speculation means we are speculating the value of a particular commodity will increase in the future. With that intention, we are going to trade in that particular commodity with the expectation that this price will increase. So it's like we are assuming that the price will increase in the market. This process is known as speculation. So how speculation can affect the companies, how speculation can affect the exchange rate movement, how it will affect the exchange rate movement, because as we have seen in the case here, we are trading in gold. In the same way, we can even trade in currencies. So let's say I have assumed that the value of the dollar will increase in the future. So assume the value of the dollar will increase in the future. So today I go and purchase, I will buy some dollars, and after a few days I am going to sell it. Okay, I assume that the value of the dollar currency is going to increase in the future. So today I purchase some dollars and later on I sold it. Okay, so what will happen? You will get a profit. So we are assuming the value of the dollar to increase in the future, thereby you are going to trade with that particular currency. So what will happen ultimately? Ultimately, because of this speculation, there will be a demand created for that dollar. Everyone will expect the dollar price is going to increase. So the demand for the dollar is getting increased in the market. So thereby the value of the dollar also getting increased in the market. So thereby we can say that speculation is one of the reason that will lead to the fluctuation of currency movement or the exchange rate movement. One of the reasons can be the speculation. So what do you mean by speculation? Here the particular party or any third party or an investor will invest in a particular commodity with an intention to get a profit in the future. So this process is known as speculation. Is it clear, everyone? Then next reason is export and import. The level of export and import between two countries will determine the value of that currency. Suppose if from India, if there is too much of export, so what does it mean by that? So whoever purchases that commodity, our product, which is listed in rupees, so if they want to purchase that particular product, they have to convert their currency into rupees. They have to convert their currency into rupees. So what will happen there? So when these guys were converting their currency into rupees, the demand of rupees will increase in the market. The demand of rupees will increase in the market. So thereby we can create a profit. So this process is known as export and import. That's how this export and import can impact the exchange rate movement of a company. So is it clear, everyone? Okay. So the next one, it is foreign direct investment. So what do you mean by foreign direct investment? So foreign direct investment says that the same way, if the company is making some foreign currency loans, or foreign currency investment, what will happen? There is a cash inflow and outflow will happen from that currency to our country, right? Suppose if you are investing in another country, you need the investment to be done in their domestic currency. So what will happen? The domestic currency of that particular country will, the demand of that domestic currency of our country of our investment will get increased. In the same way, if you are taking foreign currency loan, again there is a cash flow movement happening there. Then foreign currency remittance. What do you mean by foreign currency remittance? Let's say those who are working in Dubai or UAE, when they are converting their cash into our home country, even that will create a demand for that particular currency. Clear? So these are the different ways in which the supply and demand of our currency will get affected, and thereby it will affect the exchange rate as well. The exchange rate is determined too much of this many factors. What are they? It can be speculation, this can be export and import, or foreign direct investment, or foreign currency loan, or foreign currency remittance. So is it clear, everyone?
Sir.
Okay. The next one, it is how currency fluctuate. How currency fluctuate. So the currency fluctuation can happen. The currency fluctuation can happen. The currency fluctuation can happen. And it actually follows the laws of fund price. So law of fund price says that or the purchasing power parity, that is known as purchasing power parity. So by considering the above factors, we are trying to find out if we know the spot rate, we are trying to predict the future rate with the purchase power parity theory. So purchase power parity theory says that the reason for difference in the value of currency is because of the relative inflation. Because for a country which is having a higher inflation, their currency value will be a higher amount or a lower amount. Let's think about it. For a currency which is having a higher inflation, what's the impact it can create on your currency value? So if it's a higher inflation, if the inflation is higher, then the value of currency will go down. Value of the currency will go down. If you have a higher inflation, the value of currency will go down. The same way, if you have a lower inflation, then what will happen to the value of currency?
Higher.
the value of currency will be high. So that's what even purchase power parity said. If you are considering two countries, which country is having a higher inflation, their currency value will be lower, and which country having a higher interest rate, that higher inflation rate, their value of currency will be lower, and lower inflation rate, their value of currency will be higher. So on basically on this concept, they developed a formula for calculating the future rate. So they estimated that in future, any change in the exchange rate will depend upon the relative inflation between two countries. Okay, so we know the spot rate, and if we know the inflation rates of two countries, on the basis of that inflation rate, we can predict the future rate, the future exchange rate, that is spot rate into 1 plus first country rate in inflation rate divided by 1 plus second country rate. So here the question is, how will you identify which one is first currency and which is second currency, or which is first country or second country? We can identify it with the help of the exchange rate. Let's say if they are told that for $1 it is euros 1.43. $1 is equal to 1.43. So here the question is, which is second currency and which is first currency? The first currency and the second currency determination is not made on the basis of the fact that which is foreign currency or home. It is completely based upon the fact that how you are quoting your exchange rate. It is completely determined on the factor that how you will quote your exchange rate. Let's say here they have said that for $1 it is euro 1.43. So what does it mean by that? For $1 it is euro 1.43. What does it mean by that? Here we have represented the exchange rate. So here we have represented the exchange rate in terms of dollars. Here we are representing the exchange rate in terms of dollars. What I mean to say is, here the dollar is our base currency. The dollar is our base currency. So that base currency is known as second currency. Okay, so that currency will come in the denominator, or in which currency you are representing that particular, we are quoting that exchange rate. That is known as, that's how you will understand which is first currency and which is second currency. So if it is $1 is equal to euro 1.43, it means that for $1 you have to pay 1.43 euros. So which is the base currency here? Dollar is the base currency here. So which one will consider as your second country? Second country will be your base currency country, or we can directly say that is the second currency. So that is, and the first currency will be the opposite one. First currency will be the opposite one. So that is euro will be the first currency. The country which use euro, it will be your first country. Okay, so if you are asked to calculate the future spot rate, the future rate, you can calculate it by the formula, that is spot rate multiplied by 1 plus first country's rate divided by 1 plus second country's rate. So have you understood how to determine the first country and the second country? Is it clear, everyone? Okay, fine. So if there is a quote, if they are quoting the exchange rate like this, so here what does it mean by it? For $1 we have to pay 1.43 euros. So what's the base currency here? They are represented in dollars. That is, for $1 how much euros needs to be paid. So that currency which is considered to be the base, this is known as the second currency. And the opposite currency will be a, that is euro. That euro will be a first currency. So the currency in which we actually represent that particular exchange rate is known as the second currency or the base currency. So here I have told that for $1 it is 1.43 euros, or let's say if I said for $1 it is rupees 65. So our home country is, we know that the rupees, and the USA is a foreign country, that is dollar. So the first currency and the second currency, we are not determining on the base that which is home and which is foreign. We should look at the exchange rate. We should look at the way that how they are called the exchange rate. So here it is, for $1 you have to pay rupees 65. So that base currency is what? The base currency is USA. So that will be considered as the second currency, and rupees will be a first currency. Is it
Okay,
clear?
got it. Yes, sir.
So if you're asked to calculate the expected spot rate or future spot rate, how will you calculate it? Is equal to current spot rate into 1 plus inflation of first currency divided by 1 plus inflation of second currency. Is it clear, everyone? So which theory explain this? PPP, that is purchasing power parity. So purchasing power parity explains that if there is no inflation, we can purchase anything at equal price, that is law of fund price. That's the concept we follow here in purchasing power parity. Yeah. Next one, it is interest rate parity. So what does it interest rate parity explains? In the same way, interest rate says that we know that which country is having high inflation. Their particular currency value will be lower. Their particular currency value will be lower because which country is having high inflation? In order to reduce the inflation, those country will peak. Will make sure that they will keep high, since there is high inflation, they will keep the interest rate high. They will keep high interest. Why? So that inflation means there is huge cash outflow in the economy, right? So here we are just trying to increase the cash. In order to decrease that cash flow movement in our economy, we are keeping high interest. So high inflation, then we will keep high interest rate. So that by keeping high interest rate, what will happen there? Demand will go down, or the people will start saving. So we can say that in a way, the country which is having high interest rate, they will be having a lower currency value. And the same way for the countries which are having a lower interest rate, their currency value will be high. So here, in the same way as we have done there for the inflation concept, here there is interest rate parity, that is IRP. So interest rate parity explains that you can calculate the forward rate, you can calculate the forward spot rate if you know the current spot rate. So if you know the current spot rate, you can calculate the forward rate. How will you calculate it? That is current spot rate into 1 plus first currency divided by 1 plus second currency. So if you want to calculate the forward spot rate, how will you calculate it? It is current spot rate into 1 plus first currency divided by 1 plus second currency. Is it clear? Is it clear, everyone, the forward?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. So in purchase power parity, they explained the purchase power parity. They explained the reason is inflation. Inflation is the taken as the base for change in the exchange rate. The interest rate parity the interest rate parity they are using interest. They are using interest as their higher currency. Sorry, they are using interest. They are using interest to predict the future rate or the forward rate. So thereby Fisher have developed a formula that we have already learned it in investment appraisal. So Fisher came up with a formula. Fisher have told that 1 plus I, that is the interest of every country, will be 1 plus R into 1 plus H. So this is the formula here, the identified for calculating the interest rate of a country, that is 1 plus I is equal to 1 plus R into 1 plus H. So here R is the real rate of return and H is the inflation and I is the interest rate. So Fisher have told that if you are considering two countries, like let's say USA and UK, and if you are comparing their interest rate and inflation, and if you are trying to calculate this R, that's the real rate of return. This R will be same for every country. The real rate of return will be same for every country. If there is a change in the overall return, if there is a change in the interest rate, that change is because of the factor, that is 1 plus R into 1 plus H. The change is because of the inflation, that is 1 plus R into 1 plus H is equal to 1 plus I. And this R is the real rate of return. It will be same for every country. That's what explained by the Fisher. This is known as Fisher effect. Is it clear, everyone?
Yes, sir.
Yeah.
Sir, do we have this PPT in the group, sir?
Yeah, sir. So next one, it is expectation theory. So it is nothing difficult. So expectation theory says that ultimately the future rate which is predicted by PPP and the forward rate which is predicted by IRP, ultimately in future it will be the same. We'll expect this price will be the rate which they are calculating. Ultimately, this amount will be almost the same. That's what explained by the expectation theory. Because there is a relationship between the interest rate and the inflation. So they have said that whatever the rate which is calculated by the purchasing power parity and the forward rate, so ultimately this rate will be the same in future. So that's what explained by the expectation theory. Okay, so expectation theory is something which consider the Fisher effect, then the purchasing power parity and the interest rate parity. So by considering this all these three theories, the expectation theory have explained that after a particular period of time, the rate which is calculated by using the purchasing power parity theory and the interest rate parity theory, it will be almost the same in future. Is it clear, everyone? So next one it is, so as of now we have discussed about different types of exchange rate fluctuation, what's the reason for exchange rate fluctuation and all this stuff. So whenever there is a change in exchange rate, because of the change in the exchange rate or because of this exchange rate, there can be three types of risk. What are they? Transaction risk, translation risk and economic risk. So basically there are three types of risk. What are they? The transaction risk, translation risk and the economic risk. So out of which, first of all, we'll discuss what do you mean by transaction risk. So as we have seen earlier, when we have received a receipt, we are getting a lower receipt. In the same way, if it was a payment, if the exchange rate moving in adverse, it may result in a higher payment. So if the exchange rate is affecting the transaction, especially the short-term transactions of a company, as a result, it is resulting in a higher outflow or a lower inflow. Such kind of risk is known as transaction risk. Such kind of risk is known as transaction risk. The risk which you have seen earlier with regards to that foreign receipt. Is it clear, everyone? What do you mean by transaction risk?
Yes, sir.
Okay. In the same way, there is something known as translation risk. So what do you mean by translation risk? Let's say if you have any foreign subsidiary or something like that. Let's say the foreign subsidiary is in dollar and our company is in UK, that is in pound. So at the reporting date, we know that if it's a foreign subsidiary, we need to consolidate it. That is, when we consolidate it, we'll consolidate the efforts of our parent company should get added with the efforts of subsidiary company. But can we add dollar and the pound? No. So what do you have to do there? We have to convert the results of this foreign subsidiary into pound. Then only we can do the consolidation process. So at the reporting date, for the consolidation purpose, if you are converting these items, if you are converting this amounts into the home currency, so there is actually no exchange rate movement, is not like actually there is no cash flow movement happening, but whatever the amount which is returned in the efforts of a foreign company will get converted to our home currency at the reporting date. If there is an asset or a liability or whatever it is, will convert these amounts into home currency. So when we convert it, as per the consolidation requirement, we have to convert it at the closing rate. So as per the consolidation rules, we have to convert it at the closing rate. The SOFP will get converted at the closing rate. So when we convert it at the closing rate, as we have seen in the case of receivables, there can be some increase or decrease in the value of asset due to the change in the exchange rate. Because the value of that asset in the opening will be different compared to value of the asset in the closing. There can be some depreciation or something like that. So thereby there will be change in the value of asset. But apart from those changes, there can be some change in the values when it's getting converted into home currency because of the adverse exchange rate movement. Let's say if you have a building which is worth $5 million, if you have converted it at the acquisition date, the amount is coming to, let's say, £3 million. At the reporting date, when you have converted the same building, assume that's an investment property, there is no depreciation or something like that. So when you have converted the same building to the home currency, the amount is exactly the same. In dollar it is 5 million. But when we have converted it, we will be converting at the closing rate. So what will happen? If the closing rate is not favorable to us, then the value of this currency will go. Is it clear, everyone? So the value of the currency goes down, as well as it will decrease the value of our asset as well. So if the value of the foreign currency, if it is going down, it will decrease the value of our asset as well. So here actually there is no cash flow movement. We are just translating. So this process is known as translation. We are converting the foreign currency figures into home currency. So at the time of translation, because of the adverse exchange rate movement, the overall economy is facing an issue. Because of the adverse exchange rate movement, the overall economy is facing some issue. Okay. So that particular factor, that is whenever there is a foreign subsidiary, okay, we have to do consolidation. So at the time of consolidation, we have to convert it into our home currency. So when we do the conversion, we will be doing it at the closing rate. Okay, so if the value of that foreign currency goes down, even the value of our asset will also go down. So is it a risk for us? Is it a risk for us? Is it a risk for us? Yes. So it will be a risk for us, and such kind of risk is known as
translational risk.
Okay. The last one, it is economic risk. The last type of exchange rate risk is economic risk. So what do you mean by economic risk? In simple terms, we know that ACC is more expensive to us. Why? Because they are paying 110 pound is not a big amount there. Because even if you are working as a part-time employee, you can earn more than 500 pound or something like that, or 2500 minimum in UK. So for a guy who is earning 2500 pound, for him this 110 pound is not a, in 3 months time if you have to pay 110 pounds, for him it's a cheaper amount. So for you, for those who are in UK, for them it's a cheaper amount. So what about Indians? For us it is 10,000 rupees or 11,000 rupees. So what's the reason for that difference? It is because of the difference in the economy. That product seems to be more expensive for us. Okay. So whenever you are trading in this kind of item, so when is, think from the perspective of ACCA. So when ACCA is planning to extend their market to India, what is one of the greatest disadvantages they have is, in India we already have CA and this is very cheaper for us. So that's the main reason why normally different people doesn't choose ACCA, because it is more expensive. So that happens for every country. So whenever a country from a higher economy planning to do their marketing in a country where the economy is not as great, so there can be this issue, their product seems to be more expensive. So what ACCA have done there, so they have made some uniqueness to their qualification. They have said that, okay, you will get specified in this area, okay, you will get more knowledge in IFRS, and we are more updated, and our syllabus is almost, which is relevant to the company scenarios. Okay, so thereby they try to make this particular course more unique, and they made it more flexible compared to CA. Okay, so thereby they created a market. They are slowly creating a market here. So that's what happened. So there is a risk for ACCA. That risk cannot be avoided. But what they have done there? So instead of changing their fees, what they have done there, they tried to bring up uniqueness to their product. So whenever there is a company, whenever for every company this will be there. Okay. So for a higher from the higher economy, if they are bringing some of their product to a lower economy country where there is a lower economic growth, in that scenario, their product seems to be more expensive. If they have to compete with their existing competitors, they have only one option. Either they can increase the price or decrease the price. But if they decrease the price, then it will affect their profitability. So what they have done, they have tried to bring up uniqueness to their product. Okay. And again, if they felt that, okay, it's not going to work here, then we'll move to, then again, the demand is not getting increased. Suppose if the demand was not getting increased, they would have gone to some other countries such as US or something like that, where it is more developed. So this is a scenario where a company from a higher economy going to lower economy. In the same way, suppose if you are introducing something to the UK market, for them our product seems to be more cheaper, so thereby there will be some cost of marketing our products in UK, right? So we will incur the cost, but we are not going to get a greater profitability there. But if you are trying to increase the fees, if you are trying to increase the value of this product, if you are trying to increase the price of the product in a higher economy, what will happen there? The existing competitors will overcome our competition because we are keeping a higher price. So again, there we can choose, there we can opt the same choice that what how we can win in that competition, make some uniqueness or create a branding for our product. Thereby, the people will be ready to pay how much amount which we are quoting for that price. Right? So here that's what happens. Now, even for the branded products, we know that it's getting imported from overseas. Still, it is having a demand in the market because of that branding or the brand name. Right? People are ready to pay for it. So branding or branding name is something that will help us to survive in any market. Otherwise, what should we do? We should go to a place where we get the cheaper labels and all these stuffs. Let's say if you're a car manufacturing company, try to shift your car manufacturing from India to Japan or China so that you can make it at a very low cost, and even if you sell it in the UK, it will be profitable for you because the cost is low there compared to what the cost which you're incurring when we used to manufacture it in India. Okay? So these are the ways in which we can avoid the economic risk. Either change the market in which you are actually trading. Okay. Otherwise, bring up differentiation to the differentiation or uniqueness or create brand awareness for your product. So these are the ways in which we can reduce the economic risk. So basically, there are three types of risk: transaction risk, translation, and economic. So transaction is something that is affecting the transaction of the company. Translation means it is something that is affected by to the company when they are subjected to exchange rate, and because of the adverse movement in the exchange rate, it will affect the transactions of the company. That is receipts and payment. That is known as transaction risk. Translation means it is not affecting the cash outflow or inflow, but basically what we have purchased in past or what we have incurred as liability in the past, now it is turning out to be a burden for us because of the adverse exchange rate movement. And finally, there is economic risk. Because of the difference in the economy or in the market value of the currency, there is a difference in the gap. There is a gap in the exchange rate. So that way it will make our product more expensive if you are from a lower economy moving on to a higher economy. The same way, if you are a higher econ company from a higher economy, you are going to a lower economy, even they will face this issue because their product seems to be more expensive. So in order to be profitable, we have three options in the case of economic risk. What are the three options? Either we can shift out to an entire new market. Okay, that's an option. Then what's the option? We can expand our operation to a country where we will get cheaper labors. Then what else? Bring uniqueness or create brand awareness for our product. So these are the ways in which we can avoid economic risk. So if it is translation risk, how will you avoid the economic risk? If it is translation risk. So I've told that if you have an asset, the value of that investment in foreign currency goes down because of the adverse movement. That's what the translation risk is. So how will you internally hedge that particular risk? Internally, how will you hedge it? We know that if there is a value of an asset, if there is an asset, if the value of the asset decreases, try to keep liabilities in the foreign country as much as possible. So that if the value of the asset goes down, then liability value also goes down. So net effect, that risk won't affect us. Or keep large bulk amount of assets in home country there, so that even though there is a risk from the foreign country, it is not going to affect your company. So these are the examples, or these are the ways in which we can hedge for currency risk, and especially with regards to internally, how we can hedge the currency risk, especially with regards to economic risk, as well as next one it is, what are the three type of risk? Translation. And transactions. So altogether, we have discussed about the three We are discussing about the internal hedging methods through which we can reduce the translation